Welcome back. In the morning session, we looked at the availability and exergy analysis. Actually, I should only say combined first and second law analysis. And now we go to the second part of the combined first and second law analysis, and that is for open systems. So, combined first and second law. Again, the procedure is very similar, but we will simplify the procedure and consider a rather special case. As you know, we have reduced or we have derived the first law for open systems considering a typical one inlet, one exit type of a system. Although we derived the general case of a transient, for many, many problems, we looked at the steady state. So, for open systems, we will consider the special case. One inlet, one exit, and steady state. Extending this to a situation where you have more than one inlets or exits is reasonably straightforward. Okay. You just have to replace some terms by appropriate summations. Taking care of the general case of unsteady state requires you to derive in a fashion similar to the case for the closed system. So, even that appropriate term you can add. So, I would write here general case, that is m inlets, n exits, and transient is left as an exercise to participants. Now, the typical situation which is considered is as follows. We have a system one inlet I, one exit E, and power output W dot S. Of course, this does not include the flow work at inlet to exit, that is why that subscript S. Now, the heat interactions, again we will say as earlier, let there be some heat interaction rate Q dot 1 from a source at T 1 and another interaction rate Q dot naught to T naught, and it is this interaction rate which is the so called slack variable. And our aim is to derive a relation between W dot S and the other parameters and then try to find out the situation where the entropy production rate S dot P can be reduced to 0. We would expect that to increase our W dot S to W dot S max. We will use first law, we will use second law. So, as before, we will be using the first law, we will be using the second law, we will be using the definition of S dot P, and we will proceed from there. So, this is going to be the situation, and of course, without saying so, which is not written here, we will be assuming steady state, and at the inlet and exit, notice that because it is steady state, we do not have to worry about the change or rate of change in the state of the system. So, rate of change of energy of the system will be 0 with respect to time, rate of change of entropy of the system with respect to time will be 0, rate of change of volume of the system with respect to time will also be 0. And since the system is not changing, there will be no difference between that. We do not have to define as W dot S useful, because that P naught delta V term will become a term which would be P naught into dV of the system by dt, rate of change of volume of the system with time. And since we are considering steady state, the rate of volume of the system with time is 0, because the volume of the system is not changing with time. We will also assume that at inlet and exit, the energy is made up of U plus the kinetic energy V squared by 2 plus Gz at inlet and exit. Okay. So, we do not have to worry about any electrical work, etc. This is the assumption which you have made and which gives us the term He plus H plus V squared by 2 plus Gz. And what I am going to do is, again, to keep the algebra simpler, I am not going to write these terms and say that I will just use H, but wherever you see H, if appropriate, you will replace it by H plus V squared by 2 plus Gz. That will just simplify my algebra, our algebra. Okay. So, let us apply now first law to this system. The general expression, because it is steady state and there is only one stream flowing, one inlet, one outlet, Q dot minus W dot S equal to m dot in delta H, that is enthalpy rise from inlet to exit, He minus Hi plus V squared and all that. Here Q dot is made up of two streams. So, we will have a Q dot 1 plus Q dot naught minus W dot S equal to m dot into He minus Hi. The right hand side turns out to be simply He minus Hi. If you want to be particular, you can write plus delta E k plus delta E p, but these things you do not have to. Actually, I think I should put it in some other color, because I am not going to, for example, I will put it in green. So, if you insist, you can have plus delta E k plus delta E p, but I am not going to carry over these terms. You can add them as needed. So, let us say this is my equation 1 representing first law. Now, the second law and the definition of S dot P would bring us to the following equation: Q dot 1 by T 1 plus Q dot naught by T naught plus S dot P equal to m dot into S E minus S I. This will be my equation 2, with the second law actually being represented by S dot P being greater than or equal to 0. Now, again our aim is to reduce S dot P to 0. In the standard case, keep Q dot 1 T 1, the inlet I, the exit E. And of course, because it is steady state, P naught does not have a presence here, but sorry, P naught does not have a presence, all this thing you keep fixed. Okay. Reduce S dot P to 0 and W dot S will then go to W dot S max. Because if you want to change Q dot S dot P, nothing is allowed to be changed here. So, actually here you should put even M dot. Nothing is allowed to be changed here. Nothing is allowed to be changed in Q dot 1, T 1 and T naught. So, S dot P as it changes, only Q naught will change, and as Q naught changes, W dot S will change. And we want a direct relation between S dot P and W dot S. So, we will eliminate Q dot 0 from these two equations. So, the second equation after multiplying it by T naught will become, I hope I write it correctly now, Q dot 1 into T naught by T 1 plus Q dot 0. That takes care of the first two terms. Then we will have T naught S dot P on the right hand side, we will have M dot into S C minus S I into T naught. Yes. The first equation remains unchanged. Q dot 1 plus Q dot naught minus W dot S equals M dot into H E minus H I. Okay. So, let me call this equation 3 and equation 4. Equation 3 is nothing but equation 2 multiplied by T naught. Equation 4 is actually nothing but equation 1. Let me not confuse. So now, all that you do is subtract equation 1 from equation 3 or equation 3 from equation 1, and you will get Q dot 1 into 1 minus T naught by T 1. This will get eliminated, Q dot minus Q dot. You will have minus W dot S minus T naught S dot P equal to M dot into H E minus H I minus T naught into S E minus S I. Okay. And we will now get to write W dot S on one side, and we will put everything in. Q dot 1, okay. So this term is taken care of. Now I will write here minus M dot into H E minus T naught S E minus H I minus T naught S I. Now all that remains is minus T naught S dot. Now this gives us a direct relation between S dot P on one side and W dot S on the other side. And notice that none of these parameters are allowed to be changed. Inlet and exit states are the same. So I should write this correctly. Does not look nice. H E minus T naught into S I. So, T naught is fixed, T 1 is fixed, Q 1 is fixed, exit state is fixed, so HE and SE is fixed, inlet state is fixed, so HI, SI is fixed, M dot is also fixed. So, that means now I can rewrite this as the maximum power output minus the so called lost power. So, let me write this as W dot lost is T naught S dot T. Let us go back a few slides and compare this with this slide. W dot lost is this. Let me write it in exactly this format. Now, this W dot S max will be made up of two terms, a Q dot term and an M dot term. The Q dot term will be now again let us write down the terms. First, this is the max power obtained from Q dot 1 at T 1, a term we are familiar with from the earlier analysis. Now, this one including the negative sign is max power that can be obtained or delivered, same thing, when the stream M dot goes from inlet I to exit without having any heat interaction with anything other than the surroundings. That is, only Q naught is allowed, this Q dot 1 of any kind is not allowed. And this one is lost work, and we now see lost power, and W dot lost is similar T naught S dot. So, this one is very clear, and now look at these terms. There is a term here HE minus T naught SE, there is a term here HI minus T naught SI. So, I would say common definition, but not the definition, not a standard definition. We define, now the term here used sometimes is B, sometimes it is used as small phi. Let me use the word B because small phi, capital phi sometimes is confused. Okay. B, which is defined as H minus T naught S, is often called the exergy of state HS, state at HS when environment is at T naught. Just the way we had the definition of availability of a state given by EVS when the environment was at P naught, T naught. Okay. Sometimes this is also known as flow exergy. Or exergy of flow. That is because, as I said, sometimes even that E plus P naught V minus T naught S is also known as exergy. So, that is exergy of a non-flow system. This is the exergy of a flow, a state which is involved in flow. And with this, now we will see that this can be written down as W dot, using this W dot max, because of flow from inlet to exit without any heat obtained from a source other than the environment, turns out to be minus m into BE minus EI. So, this indicates that BE is something like a potential, this has to be m dot. Okay. The crease in which represents the max power that can be obtained when I is the inlet and E is the exit. Decrease because of this negative sign. Now, before we go to exercises, there are a few things to notice. That when we say maximum power, this is always the maximum power delivered by a system. So, note W actual will always be less than or in the limit equal to W dot S, W dot S max. And again, notice here that S dot P represents the amount of power which has been lost because of ability or non-ideal behavior. And similar to the closed system situation, the factor which converts it into lost power is T naught, the environment temperature. Now, this is always less than or equal to whatever is the type of equipment you have. Okay. For example, I will draw a line like this with a 0 here, a positive here and negative here. This is the simply the real number line. If you have something like a turbine, which is supposed to deliver power, and on the other side you have something like a compressor which is supposed to absorb power. In either case this is true, this thing is true. In case of a turbine, W dot S max would be something like this. W dot S would be a positive number less than this. So, this much is the power lost because of irreversibility in a turbine. Okay. Here both W dot S and W dot S max are both positive. Like 100 megawatt, 90 megawatt, or 10 kilowatt, 6 kilowatt. But for a compressor, both are negative, but the relative position remains the same. W dot X max, W dot S, and the lost power is this. So, here both are negative. So, let me put the illustration here. For example, this is plus 100 kilowatt, whereas W dot S could be say plus 86 kilowatt. So, 14 kilowatt is the lost power, 100 minus 86. So, W dot lost is 14 kilowatt. Out here, both are negative. So, let us say the actual power consumed by a compressor would be W dot S would be minus say 50 kilowatt. It is consumed, so it is negative with our sign convention. W dot S max will be higher than this algebraically. So, for example, this could be minus 40 kilowatt. It has to be to the right side of W dot S on the negative to positive number line, just the way W dot S is right side of W dot S here, W dot S max is on the right side of W dot S here. Consequently, minus 40, minus 50, minus 40, minus, minus 50. So, here W dot loss will be 10 kilowatt. Whether this or this, the W dot lost will always be this will be always positive or in the limit 0. This is what one should realize. Do not make a mistake by saying the turbine, the ideal power is higher than the actual power delivered. For compressor, the ideal power is less than the power. It is less numerically. If you take the amplitude or magnitudes of this, 40 kilowatt is numerically lower than 50 kilowatt, but because the compressor is a work absorption device, actually the power delivered by the actual compressor is minus 50 kilowatt. We can say that it consumes 50 kilowatt, but the power delivered is always negative for a compressor, so it is minus 50 kilowatt. The ideal power delivered will be algebraically higher than this, say minus 40 kilowatt. So, W lost in either case is, in this case is plus 10 kilowatt. The W lost cannot ever be a negative number. And of course, you can use such a number line even for a non-flow process, in which case you will have WU max and WU here, and here also you will have a WU max and WU. Now, let us come to exercises, and here in fact the confusion is wider. And that is why we will now come to the efficiency by different laws. For example, you take a turbine. When we came to open systems, we defined what is known as the isentropic efficiency of the turbine. It was defined as the power output of the turbine divided by the ideal power output. And the ideal power output of the turbine was defined as the power that would have been delivered by the turbine if the inlet and exit states were to be isentropic. That is, SE star would have been equal to SI. In that case, the W star, WS star is the maximum or ideal power that goes into the denominator. The actual power, which is for the inlet state SI and the exit state SC, where SC is higher than SI, was denoted by W dot S, and the ratio of these two, W dot S to W dot S star, was the isentropic efficiency of the turbine. When you apply this exergy principle or use this exergy analysis for a turbine, the exergy analysis, the standard exergy analysis, considered fixed inlet and exit states. Notice, situation considered is fixed inlet and exit states. I have written it somewhere here, fixed inlet and exit states. Okay. So, the exergy analysis, if you were to apply this to a turbine, would give you the maximum power that can be obtained by a turbine if the inlet and exit states were fixed. Okay. And in that case, what would be the maximum power obtained? However, if you talk to a turbine engineer, the turbine would say that, look, I am not so worried about the exit state. I want a better turbine which is as near an isentropic turbine as possible. So, he is looking at a turbine not from the exergy analysis point of view, but from his or her point of view. And when we come to an exercise here, that difference would be very clear to us. For example, let us look at the exercise, which is CL4. This is an important exercise because it has both the aspects which are asked for. Okay. We have here, let us read it, air at 1200 K and 8 bar expands in an adiabatic turbine to 1 bar with an isentropic efficiency of 0.85. and the airflow rate is 2 kg per second. Now, in the determine, first is power output. So, up to here, up to the end of part A, it is simply a first law open systems problem. The additional information needed is the isentropic efficiency. It is given that we have an adiabatic turbine, adiabatic air turbine. The inlet is 1200 K 8 bar. Exit is 1 bar. We are given that the isentropic efficiency is 0.85. What is the power output that can be easily determined? First, let us sketch the HS or TS diagram. Although I am sketching TS, it will be HS to a scale between T and H. Let us say that this is the 8 bar line and this is the 1 bar line, constant pressure lines, isobar. Let us say this is the inlet state I. If the turbine were isentropic, this would be the exit state E star. The actual turbine is not isentropic, so the exit state is E. Actual process would be something like this. We will make the following assumptions. Apart from the given data that P naught is 1 bar, T naught is 300 K. So, we will assume, apart from P naught is 1 bar, which is not needed, but T naught is 300 K, which may be needed. We will assume air to be an ideal gas with constant Cp, Cv. There is some ant moving around this place. We will assume that the turbine works under a steady state. We do not have to assume that it is adiabatic, it is given. And we will assume that delta Ek between inlet and exit and delta Ep between inlet and exit are negligible, both of them. Now, this means because it is an air turbine, W dot S would be m dot into h I minus h e, which would be equal to m dot into C p into T I minus T e. Okay. Here I have used the fact that air is a ideal gas, constant specific heats. And here I have used the fact that delta E k, delta E p are negligible. The turbine is adiabatic and it is a steady state. Okay. Now, we will have the definition of eta s is given. Eta s is given, so this is W dot s by W dot s star, indicating under isentropic conditions. Okay. So, let me say this is equation 1, this is equation 2. This is equation 3, and W dot S star would be in a similar fashion m dot Cp Ti minus Te star 4, whereas where Te star is the ideal exit state. Where Pe star is Pe, but S e star equals S. Now, because of this and because of the fact that we have used assumed air to be a an ideal gas with constant specific heats, we can write in terms of gamma this expression that T e star by T I would be P e star by P I, but P e star is P e, so we do not have to worry about it. This is going to be raised to gamma minus 1 by gamma. This will be equation 5. So, here notice that P I is known, P e star is known, P e star is P e, T I is known. So, from 5 we will obtain T e star. This is the first step. Second step, using T e star we obtain W dot S star. This is the second step. The third step is using W dot S star and eta S, we obtain W dot S. So, this gives you W dot S, third step. Using W dot S and m dot Cp, if it is given to you, is m dot given? It is not given, but we can assume then m dot to be 1 kg per second, or work in terms of W dot S star divided by m dot. M dot does not come into operation. Oh, m dot is given 2 kg per second. Did I write it anywhere? Forgot to write it. M dot is 2 kg per second. So, even the powers can be calculated. So, from now W dot S is known, substitute that in 2, M dot is known, Cp is known for air, Ti is known, so Te comes out of it. So, Te, that is step 4. So, this is the way it goes, although we write the equation as 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, first step is this, second step is this, third step is this, fourth step is this. And of course, in between we have determined W dot S, which is the power output A. So, this one is the answer A. Now, the next part of this, and that is maximum possible output for the same inlet and exit conditions. So, this is the standard exergy analysis, B, W dot S max for the same inlet and exit conditions. That means the inlet must be Pi, Ti. And exit must be PE, TE, and TE as calculated by the earlier expression, this value of TE. Now, this requires, for because it is same inlet and exit conditions, and we are not allowed to have any other heat exchange except with the environment, this standard exergy analysis or standard exergy formulation. So, we will be using this expression. Where did it go? Yes. W dot S max, this term would be 0. So, that will be minus M dot into HE minus T naught SE minus HI minus T naught SI. So, this will give us W dot S max, which will turn out to be minus M dot. You can work in terms of B, but I will work algebraically so that the significance of various terms comes into play, it becomes clear. This is M dot into HE minus T naught AC minus HI minus T naught SI. Okay. Now, let us combine these terms. So, rearrange this, M dot into HE minus HI, I will write as M dot into HI minus HE. So, I have taken care of the H terms. Now, I have T naught. This is, there is a negative term here. So, T naught into SI minus T naught into SE, but there is a minus M dot. So, you end up with plus M dot into SE minus SI. Okay. And now notice that this M dot into HI minus HE term, M dot into HI minus HE term, this one or its equivalent in the temperature mode is W dot S. And notice again from our TS diagram that SE, and this is going to be SI, which is SE star. So, this number SE minus SI is always going to be a positive, or in the limit of isentropic efficiency being 1, which is not in this case, a 0 number. So, this is going to be greater than 0, since SE is greater than S E star, which in turn is equal to S I. Consequently, the maximum power which you can obtain is higher than the actual power by this, sorry, I forgot to write T naught here, the dimension is higher than the actual power delivered by this term, which is m dot into S E minus S I into T naught, and this term is the lost power. So now, the maximum power output for the same inlet and exit conditions, so that is B. So this thing which now can be calculated, because we know the exit state, we know the inlet state, this is already calculated. All that we have to do is calculate SE minus SI and we can determine W dot S max. So this is answer B. And again, if you are not sure how S E minus S I is calculated, we should note here that S E minus S I is S E minus S E star, because S I and S E star are equal, I and E star being isentropic states by definition, and hence now S E and S E star are on the same isobar, S E and S E star are on the same isobar. So under the assumption which we have made that the working fluid is an ideal gas with constant specific heats, this turns out to be C P ln T E by T E star, and you will work the problem by assuming a certain C P for air. And we have already calculated T E and T E star, and that is done here. For example, here T E star is calculated, here T E is calculated. So we can determine S E minus S E star, which is S E minus S I. Which is S E minus S I, and from that we can determine the lost power. It has not been asked what is the lost power, but that can also be determined. Now, this is okay from a thermodynamics point of view, but how will this power be obtained? What should we do to this turbine to keep the inlet and exit states the same, but obtain more power? And for that, you will have to see that to obtain more power, you should apply first law to the turbine under the ideal situation. What has happened is your inlet and exit states remain the same, HI and HE, but your inlet and exit states remain the same, mass flow rate remains the same. So the first law says that if you just have an adiabatic turbine from inlet to exit, you can't change this W dot S. But then where will you obtain the additional power from? The additional power would be obtained by making it a non-adiabatic turbine and having a 2T reversible heat engine working between the environment and the turbine, a maybe complicated adjustable reversible heat engine, which would provide you the additional power which is shown in this expression as W dot lost. Now, the turbine engineer says, look, I do not want anything complicated. For me, an adiabatic turbine would be an ideal turbine when it is reversible and adiabatic. That means the inlet and exit states would be isentropic. A turbine engineer is not interested in keeping the, of course, he does not have a choice of the inlet state that comes from the, for a gas turbine, from the combustion chamber exit. But he says there is nothing special about the exit state. I would like to make it a adiabatic reversible, that means isentropic turbine, by bringing E down to E star. And that is the question which is asked. maximum power output if the turbine were to remain adiabatic. What is the exit state in this case? In this case, we have already solved the problem. The part C of this, if the turbine were to be adiabatic, that means Q dot 0 also equal to 0, then ideal situation implies a reversible turbine under the condition adiabatic. So, adiabatic turbine, reversible turbine, this implies that the ideal situation in this case is exit at SE star and power output equal to W dot S star, and both of these have been as computed in A. Now you can do these computations. I am not going to get into numericals. Remember the two definitions. We have isentropic efficiency eta S is defined as W dot S is W divided by W dot S star, where W dot S star is when S E star is S I. This is what we have seen, and this is the maximum power output under isentropic condition. Adiabatic reversible means isentropic conditions. Whereas, using the traditional exergy analysis, we have determined a W dot S max, and which has in this formulation the isentropic efficiency does not enter. It has, maybe it is entered because SE is different from SE star. So, the SE depends on what the isentropic efficiency is. But now you will notice that the actual power output divided by this W dot S max gives you another definition of efficiency. This is known as the second law efficiency, or sometimes it is also known as the exergetic efficiency. And this is defined as W dot S divided by W dot S max, whereas where this comes out of this equation. I do not have a number for it, but I have equation 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Let me say this is equation 6. So, W dot S star comes out of equation 4, whereas W dot S max comes out of equation 6. So, this is equation 4, this comes out of equation 6. The two numbers are different, which can be higher, which can be lower, that I leave it you to find out. Maybe they are higher or lower depending on the particular case at hand. But the two things are sure. that when the isentropic efficiency is 1, the exergetic efficiency will also be 1. And as the isentropic efficiency reduces below 1, the exergetic efficiency reduces below 1. Okay. Now, before I take up questions, I would like to tell you the following thing. Sometimes the situation is such that it becomes too cumbersome to apply our standard availability analysis or the standard exergetic analysis. Even then, somebody asks you to determine what is the lost work, okay, in case of a closed system, or lost power in case of an open system. In which case, remember that our first law and our second law, forget about definitions of availability, exergy, anything. If you apply first law, apply second law, then you can always determine the entropy produced, SP, or the rate of entropy production, S dot P. Okay, forget this. All that we need then to do is, for a closed system, determine lost work as SP into the environment temperature, and determine the lost power as S dot P into the environment temperature. So, of all this, the safest thing to do is determine S dot P and then determine the lost power or the lost work as either T naught S dot P or T naught S P, as the case may be. And if you, I will leave it to you to do exercise 6. A few years ago, this was an exam question which I set up. I got the idea from some statement in a book where this, something like this, was an illustration. And it is it's a good exercise, and being true to the laws of thermodynamics, the questions I have started at 0, 1, 2 and 3. I will leave it to you to discuss this among yourself and determine the lost power and all the other answers. Now, I am ready for let me wait a minute, then I am ready for interaction. 1120, St. Aloysius Institute of Technology, Jabalpur. Over to you.
Sir, you had given very good example for heat transfer, like money in the bank and money in the purse or wallet. Similarly, I have got a question that what is the difference between entropy and availability. Kindly explain the physical significance of these terms.
Okay. The first thing is, the physical significance of many terms in thermodynamics is very difficult to say, because unlike velocity, which we can physically see, or matter at a height, which we can physically see, you know, temperature is something which cannot physically see, but perhaps at least within a safe range of temperature, say between 0 degrees C and 50 degrees C, we can touch something and get a feel for that. But beyond that, when we come to, you know, internal energy or entropy, we cannot have a physical feel. And you will notice that of all the thermodynamic properties, only the temperature, which is measured by some means, more or less directly using a thermometer. But internal energy or entropy is never measured. It is always deduced from some equations or some tables. Hence, providing a physical meaning to quantities which involve internal energy and entropy is quite difficult. It is almost impossible. Okay. Number two, your question was the difference between entropy and availability. Well, as I have said earlier during these lectures today, that it is really the first law and second law which matter. So, it is only the internal energy change and the entropy change which matters. So, if you go back to our derivations, it is only the change in energy and entropy which matter. From all that, we can determine what is the entropy produced, and we can determine what is in T naught SP, which is the lost work. Everything else is simply algebra which has been done in a particular way, and my purpose in doing all this thing for you is I am always pestered by saying you didn't teach availability, you didn't teach exergy. I don't tend to teach availability and exergy except as combined first and second law, because there is no unique way that you will find it defined. All this thing is, you can say, algebraic manipulation to get finally in this form. And then what you see here, they say, is the change in availability. Some people will call it change in exergy. Of course, change in exergy is related to, for a closed system, change in energy, change in volume, change in entropy. So it's a combination of all this. And if the major component of energy, which is thermal internal energy, as well as this another component of availability, which is delta S, are something which we cannot talk about with any physical significance in mind. Availability is also something about the physical significance of which we cannot talk in words. It is something which is defined in terms of this equation, and I am showing it to you just because there are other people who have presented it in this way and called it availability analysis or exergy analysis. In fact, the only thing which we should remember out of this is SP here represents lost work, and if you were to do everything in a perfect reversible thermodynamically ideal fashion, you could have extracted some additional work, which is T naught into the entropy produced, where T naught is the ambient temperature. Over to you.
Dikshit from SAIT Jabalpur. I want to know, sir, the thermodynamic meaning of exergy destruction. Over to you, sir.
Okay. The exergy destruction is again a funny word. There are words like destruction of an exergy, or loss of exergy, or irreversibility. The lost work sometimes is known as irreversibility. The exergy destruction is only thing the following way. Come here. Okay. This is the no exergy destruction. That means if everything were reversible. So they say that this is the exergy reduction which should give you power. Now, if that much work is not obtained, that is because of exergy destroyed because of some entropy production. So, entropy production is an abstract idea, which is the imbalance in the second law of thermodynamics, that sometimes is known as exergy destruction. These are only terms which are defined. There are no new concepts involved. The only concept in which is really involved is, and the only neat definition is that of entropy produced or entropy production, which we can properly define as the differences in the two sides of the second law of thermodynamics. Over to you.
Good afternoon, sir. This is Abhishek Bhushan. Sir, I would like to know that the example of reversible processes in thermodynamics.
Okay. Well, reversible process is an ideal process, and let me take this opportunity to answer a few questions which I have turned up on the discussion forum. Okay. There still seems to be some confusion about the distinction between a quasi-static process and a reversible process. They are distinct, and one can argue that for a process to be reversible, it needs to be quasi-static. Okay. But let me make the thing clear that for a system to execute a quasi-static process, it is required that from the initial state to the final state, the system goes through a set of states. All of them can be asserted to be states of equilibrium, or can be demonstrated to be, or in a approximate situation can be approximated to be or assumed to be states of equilibrium. So, if we have a system, let us say some gas, so in PV diagram, if you have a process which can be shown to go from initial state 1. So, anytime you see the process, you will either find it here or find it here or find it here. Not only that, when it starts at 1 and suppose the whole process takes some few minutes to be executed, after a small amount of time you will find it somewhere near 1. After some more amount of time you will find it slightly further down. It is not that you will find it somewhere once here, once here. So, it is an order against time also, there is a neat variation. But notice that this is quasi-static. This is a representation of a quasi-static process. Okay. And here we are looking only at the states of the system from the initial state to a final state. We are not looking at the interactions, we are not looking at what the interacting systems are doing. Whereas a reversible process cannot be shown just by the state space of one system. In fact, a reversible process means all involved systems. Execute properly defined and reversible processes and reversible interactions. Now, the moment you say interactions, more than one systems are involved. Suppose this system, while executing this process, this system executes an interaction with respect to some other system of the thermal kind, then that interaction also has to be reversible. That means that thermal exchange, heat exchange has to be between two surfaces which are negligible, which have a negligible temperature difference, in principle 0. Okay. Suppose it is doing some expansion type of work, then the pressure difference between the system, our system, which is doing work on the neighboring system, should be negligible. Always there should be a force balance. Okay. And this makes a reversible process difficult to show in practice. Quasi-static process can be shown like this, but if I say that this is a quasi-static process, it is also a reversible process. Just by showing it, you cannot say that it is reversible. I must then know what is happening to the other systems and what are happening to the interactions. A quasi-static process is easier to understand because I can demonstrate it by showing a process line like this on state space. A reversible process cannot be shown like this because more than one system is involved quite often, and also interactions are involved, and interactions are something which I cannot show on a diagram. I can show them only by arrows and say that this heat transfer must be across negligible temperature difference and this work transfer should be across negligible pressure difference. For example, earlier in the day, I solved that problem of vacuum. Notice that that ideal work was obtained by making the process of the vacuum vanishing a reversible process by not only making it quasi-static, but arranging it in such a way that just this small impulse would execute it in one way and another small impulse or stimulus would execute it in the other. So, reversible, that is what I said, a reversible process is something to be thought about, it is a thought process, not a real process. It is just a limiting situation that we want to derive, and for that we use that thought process called reversible process. Over to you. 1140 Shastra University, Tanjavur.
I am Shiva from Shastra University. I have a doubt in the irreversible adiabatic process. while representing the irreversible adiabatic process in the TS diagram, what is the area under the curve represents?
Okay. The question is the TS diagram and area under the curve. Remember that TDS is greater than or at most equal to DQ. DS is greater than or equal to DQ by T, that is the second law of thermodynamics. Okay. So, area under the curve, that means you are looking at a quasi-static process. So, this should be DS. So, quasi-static process means you will have a representation of that. Now, this is the area is integral TDS, and as the thing represents, it will be greater than or equal to DQ. So, this is the area under area of this is greater than or equal to DQ. That is all you can say. You can't say that it is equal to DQ. You will be able to say it is equal to DQ only if it is reversible. And I will say here equality holds only for a reversible process. Over to you. Where the area is equal to 0.
Heat transfer, whether it should be equal to 0 or not.
No, if the area turns out to be 0, that only means that your Q has to be less than or equal to 0. That's all it means. Q can have any sign, positive or negative. So, for example, if this area represents 5 kilojoules, the Q has to be less than or equal to 5 kilojoules. If the area turns out to be 0, for example, in an isentropic process, area turns out to be 0, that means Q has to be 0 or negative.
My question is, because of the irreversible adiabatic process, because of the adiabatic process,
right,
the whether the Q should be always become 0, because in that representing your TS, in the TS diagram, there is some area under the curve. So, that represents the Q is not equal to 0 for irreversible adiabatic. I want to clarify that only.
No. See, Q can be anything. Let me come to this. Remember, I wrote this that DS equals DQ by T plus DSP. Multiply the throughout by T and you will get TDS equals DQ plus T DSP. Now, in all this, this DSP has to be greater than or equal to 0. So, if the area is 0, that means this is 0. Okay? This will always be positive. So, if this is 0 and if this is 0, that means this has to be positive generally, that means this has to be generally negative. In the special case where it is reversible, this will also be 0, this will also be 0. So, the equation will be satisfied at 0 equal to 0 plus 0. In case of a irreversible process, it will still be satisfied at 0 equals some negative number plus corresponding positive number.
Over and out, sir.
Okay. Thank you very much.